Welcome to the Red White News Show with Dean McMurray, the military media.
All right, here we go. Hey, everybody. Welcome back to another great episode of the Red, White, and You Show with yours truly, the military medium. Today, folks, I have a really fun guest. Richelle Futch is a Marine Corps veteran herself, a military spouse to an Army Special Forces non-commissioned officer, and she has over 15 years of clinical experience working with government agencies. And she's here today to talk about her book, her workshops, entitled Her Ruck. Richelle, welcome to the Red White News Show.
Hi, thanks for having me. I'm so glad to be here.
Absolutely, absolutely. So share with us a little bit who Richelle is. You know, take us back to, you know, you started off in the Marine Corps. How many years did you end up serving over there?
Yeah, I did one enlistment. So I did 4 years and okay. I went in pretty close to right after high school. So I'm from a small town in Washington State from Grays Harbor area, where most people know that because Kurt Cobain is from there.
Sure.
And so it's a kind of a depressed environment. A lot of the industry, like logging industry and stuff like that, they've shut down. And so there's a lot of economic difficulty there. And so I had to get out of there.
No, absolutely. Absolutely. And I know the Washington State area well. I was stationed at Fort Lewis for a while myself. And so it's an absolutely gorgeous area and a great, great outlying areas from, back in those days, it wasn't a joint, operations base or anything. It was just Fort Lewis. So, so now that you're married to an Army veteran, Army Special Operations. So how is that different now, now that the shoe in a sense is on the other foot, now you're on the other side of the looking glass. What did you see the differences? Obviously were you married at all when you were in the Marine Corps?
No, I was I did have a sort of agreement marriage. But it was short lived. It didn't really, but it wasn't the extent of my entire enlistment. It was toward the end. And so I was able to benefit a little bit when I was out.
Sure.
From that. Yeah. And then, I met my husband now, years later.
Sure. Sure. Yeah. Okay. Well, and how is it in retrospect, Richelle, cause you've been in both, I guess, houses, if you will, and being the single military member, regardless of branch, and now as the military spouse, other than the obvious differences, but are they two complete different worlds? Give us a glimpse into that a little bit. It's always interesting to hear
people. When I was in the Marines, I was younger. There definitely was a lot of uncertainty happening in my life when I went in the military. So that gave me a lot of, there was a lot of control that was happening to me. And so a lot of certainty that was happening. My mind was very specific. It's like, this is what you do. You get up, you go to work, you go to trainings, you do these things. And so it's kind of laid out for you.
Sure.
And then going to be a military spouse, I feel like it's the opposite. There's so much uncertainty because I'm not there in the action where the missions are happening. And so I get word secondhand and there's no control. I have no control over that. I don't get to say, hey, to my top or somebody like that, this is what I really want for my career. This is what I want to happen. This is where I want to go. I just am at the whim of, hey, by the way, you guys are moving here and you're doing that. Oh, and we're doing a night shoot. So I know you have clients tonight, but we need to find childcare, all those things.
Right.
And so it's so much harder being a military spouse than it was being a service member, for sure.
Right. Well, and I think a lot of times too, Richelle, and that's why I was really excited that you agreed to do the interview, because I don't think I get enough spouses on because, when I was active and remembering being single myself, a lot of people don't realize, and I think people don't understand what spouses go through. And for them to tell their side of the challenges they experience and to get that message out to other spouses going through some of the struggles and headaches and, you know, everything else. But and sometimes it can be more, right? It can be a lot of things. And it kind of brings us into your book, Her Ruck. So take us a little bit into not only that, but like, how did the concept of the book even come about?
Yeah, that's it. That's it's a great question, because for a long time it was just a table of contents in my computer for a year or two. But when my husband returned from Afghanistan the first time after we were married, you know, it was a really hard deployment. He lost a team member. And so things were shifting in our household. And then I had a baby. Then he deployed again to Afghanistan. And, you know, some of the wounds of war wasn't addressed before he went back, which then kind of lifted everything again. And so I'm hearing his side. He's not disclosing that with anybody or talking to anybody about that. I'm a mental health professional. And I'm like, what do I do with this? Because I can't, you know, I'm not treating him for sure. I'm just going, yeah, that's a problem. And this is a problem. And you need help. And this is what should be happening. And why isn't this happening? And why isn't that happening? And I looked around and I was thinking, wow, that's like his private feelings, his private emotions, his experience. And yet it's impacting me and my family so much. And I wanted to respect his privacy, and I don't want to, you know, impact his career, because that's, you know, a reality. As much as they want to say it's not, it is a reality that if you get, you know, kind of that check mark that you're not deployable right now, or you're not mission ready, it's a big impact. And so a lot of that was spilling out in our house, right? With, high anxiety, short temper, a lot of like, barking to be quiet and barking orders and distractions and things like that. And me, I'm one of those, I was a Marine. So I'm like, that's not happening here. Not today, son. You know? And that was a lot of me kind of, you know, bucking up for my self-respect and for what I wanted to be done. And at the same time, struggling because I really wanted to have compassion for what he was experiencing. And so there wasn't really a place for me to go with that. And so I started this idea of Her Ruck, his secrets of like what it takes, the weight that it takes for me to carry the stuff that I know that I'm holding for him out of respect for not sharing. And then I started talking to some other military spouses, and I, you know, started kind of disclosing some small things here and there, and they're like, oh my gosh, me too. Yes. And then they started disclosing things, and I started getting this vision. And my mental health practice, I taught a skill called your emotional backpack. And so we addressed all the stuff that we carry and we wake up with every day. And I'm like, yeah, we have this emotional rucksack that we're wearing every day. And I kind of, you know, use that language because it's military and people could relate to that. And I got this vision of just, you know, all this stuff stacking up, like, what are we bringing into our marriage? What are we bringing into the military? And then what's compounding once we're in there? And so that's kind of where the idea came from.
Well, I love it, because not only does it tie an aspect of the military, but very much visual, right? We can just, you know, if you think of any backpack, regardless of a rucksack or not, anybody can visualize weights or whatever being placed inside of a bag, right? And then the weight that, you know, is just, so whether it's emotional or physical, I love it. And, you know, going along with it, I was just reading some of it about, you know, talking about some of that passion that you had developing, it developed into a workshop unpacking your emotional ruck, and then your book, Her Ruck, inside the emotional backpack of the military wives. So take us into a little bit about the book. Now, this is basically a compilation of different stories of different spouses, right? It's just not your perspective. This is many perspectives being told by you, but through their lens, right?
Absolutely. And so I've gone over the last few years and just doing a lot of interviews with military spouses. I've given them surveys. I've spoke with them and I know a lot, you know, personally. So I've been able to tell some of my friends' stories.
Sure.
And so my story's in there and you hear that throughout. And then also, you know, specific chapters of things that I haven't personally experienced, then I go to, you know, those who have. So right. with the idea that a spouse can pick that up, flip to a chapter of something that she's dealing with and go, oh, I'm not alone. I'm not the only one. Somebody else has been through it and, or is experiencing it and they're making it through. And so sort of seeing that connection.
Nice. Nice. That, you know, and it's just so powerful when, you know, hearing you talk about that is how, you know, bring tying everything in together and saying that, you know, we haven't experienced everything, but it's interesting that we can all come together and create a healing network to help people that have had similar experiences, right?
Yes. It really shines in my workshops too, because in the first kind of warm-up exercise, this getting to know you thing, I hand out note cards to all the participants. And I've done this with green suitors. I've done this with, you know, active duty, National Sure. Guard, reserves, and military spouses. And it's always the same. I hand out a note card before the workshop starts. And then I ask them, you know, anonymously, write, fill in the following sentence. I worry about, I feel like, or I struggle with. One of those sentences, put that out. And then they write a sentence. We hand them in, I mix them up, I hand them back out, and everybody gets to read somebody else's. Mm. And it's it levels the room right away because
right.
the feedback is always, I could have written any one of those. So right. it's really great.
Right. You know, that's interesting you bring that up because we're all much more similar than we let on, right? We yeah. all struggle with a lot of things, but we don't want to say anything. And why do you feel that is, Richelle? Why do you feel that we're not like, hey, over here, I feel like I'm drowning or I can't quite handle it all. Why do you feel that is?
Well, naturally, it's hard. It's hard to open up and be vulnerable about things that we make us feel like we're weak or we're not doing. Mm. And the military community is especially hard because we normalize high levels of stress. If you look at the military community, everybody around you is dealing with high levels of stress. And so if you look around and everybody else seems to be doing fine, then you're supposed to be doing fine too. And if you're not, there's something wrong with you. And so we have this code of silence that kind of is out there because we get kudos for being hard charging warriors, you know, suck it up and just, you know, embrace it and, right. and do those things. And so it is hard to be the one to feel like you're the only one raising your hand and saying, wait a minute, I'm not doing well. And we've done a lot of, there's been a lot of strides to break down that stigma, but it's not enough clearly because right. the suicide rates are still rising.
Right. Well, do you also feel that in the military, there is almost like a stigma of feeling like a piece of equipment? And of course, in the military, once a piece of equipment is labeled broken, it's put off to the side or forgotten about or cannibalized. Do you Yes. feel that that's also, you know, I'm just another name, I'm just another number. There's 1,000 of me. You know, they can get somebody to replace me in an instant. There's somebody being trained right this second. You know, that can step in, fill my shoes and pull a trigger or do whatever.
Absolutely. You know? And you see that even when you lose somebody. So my husband's unit lost somebody, our last unit that we were at. And they, by the time they got the chaplains together and everybody together to kind of have a debrief and sort of this bonding exercise for the unit around this loss, his replacement was in the room for that. Mm. And it's like, that's a kind of a clear picture of you are replaceable. Yeah. And so if you're feeling like you're broken, granted, you do see some people, right? The ones that everybody right. likes, the ones right. that, you know, like the shining star that they get to use for an example, but that's really the far and few between. I just recently had a couple friends reaching out to go to inpatient services because mm-hmm. they were struggling. And the clinic told them that only 10% of the people that try to get in get approved to get in. And that's through TRICARE and that's through their system. And so you can be hurting and people will still say not enough.
Why is that? Is it just because the system's broken or is it just, or they are not equipped to maybe support that many?
I think they're not equipped to support that many and the system's broken. I think it's right. both. Yeah.
It's really sad, but you know, at the same time, I've said this before and it's kind of disheartening that I say it so often, because you know, when I hear statistics like that and other things, I always say it makes me sad, but it makes me happy. Because what I mean by that, makes me sad hearing that, but what makes me happy is seeing individuals not only like you, Richelle, but other folks out there that are seeing where the chinks in the chain are and saying, our men and women need more and they deserve better. And guess what? I have a specific skill set that I can step up and help. And so just like you, so whether with this book or with your counseling or whatever you happen to be doing, or maybe there's a different organization out there doing something completely different, stepping in to fill the gaps where another organization, and of course, in this instance, we're talking about TRICARE, somebody trying to get help through the system that can't. And so that is heartwarming. That is encouraging to see that people are actually, and you know what? And what's interesting is I would, you know, don't know the specific numbers, but I would dare say, you know, 98 to 99% of those people and organizations are either spouses of or themselves a veteran, to be like, this is important and it's not being addressed. And why isn't it being addressed? Right.
Right. And then we bring in this moral injury, right? This moral injury of seeing something so horrible happening and you can't do anything to change it. You can't do anything to fix it.
Right. Right. It's interesting. Yeah. Just a certainly a dynamic, you know, fluid kind of type ongoing issue that, you know, hopefully we get a handle on at some point. I really don't know if saying soon would be suffice, but I just wanted to read the, you know, Her Ruck explores the real lives of military wives who shared and sometimes lost their spouses with the war in Afghanistan and Iraq for the last 18 years. That number is just absolutely crazy, thinking that we're almost, you know, 20 years in. Mm-hmm. And the real life accounts, researches, highlights, and struggle strengths with this silent community whose sacrifices and burdens are only understood by military spouses. Through firsthand accounts, Her Ruck will speak the unspoken, and it will challenge the culture within the military, expose the real after effects and injustices of wars on families. I love that. An attempt to reduce the stigma associated with mental illness. Topics include emotional abuse, addiction, infidelity, PTSD, anxiety, misconduct, effects on kids. That's a great one. And especially since this, we were talking earlier, since we're, you know, recording here in April, which is the month of the military child, which I think is so very important as well. Overcompensation, secret keeping, myths, finding strengths, creating resilience, recognizing concerns, self-care, courageous conversations, resources, and relational skills, etc. I think that is just so awesome that somebody, and that you followed your heart to come up with a book like this. It's in a sense too very courageous of you to do that, because you have a spouse still serving. So was there a big concern, Richelle, like, God, if I come out with this book, like, what is his, like, what's going to happen to him? Like, is this going to like negatively impact him? Or at, you know, were those concerns like coming up with this?
Yes, those conversations were happening in my house. And, you know, I'm definitely a strong personality in the sense that my stories are mine. And I feel like I need to model sharing that. That's one of the things I teach in my practice. And my husband respects that. He also recognizes the issues through the struggles he's had and feeling like he wasn't getting help when he needed it. And so he thinks there's a deeper loyalty at play in telling the story that's going to last beyond his career. And so he's very supportive of it.
Nice, nice. So, you know, recognizing it's awesome to hear that he's very supportive of that. And, you know, and there is a tremendous, tremendous amount of courage within him as well, saying, you know, that's, you know, I'll let my actions speak for themselves and, you know, your product speak for itself. And really, when truth comes out, you can't argue with that, right? Even right. though if there's commands that like, I don't know if I like that. It shows, again, goes back to, because it needs to show vulnerability, right? It needs to show mm-hmm. that there's an issue. And especially sometimes commands don't want to, they, you know, on those OERs and NCERs, they want good numbers. Mm-hmm. You're like, oh, don't want to have an issue. You know, can we take yeah. care of this in-house quietly?
Right.
You know, let's not talk about the elephant in the room, so to speak. So yeah. you have another program, or not another program, but another book. You talked about it briefly before we came live, talking about, was it Little Rucks? Was that
Little Rucks? Yeah. It's going to be another workshop. So a workbook.
Nice.
For military children. Yeah.
Very cool. So just briefly share with us a little bit about that and the concept around it.
So our kids, our military kids, one of the hard parts for them is that they can grow up in the system and then mom or dad can retire. The kids are 18, 19, 20 years old, and then they're just kind of done, you know, right. after their age of TRICARE, but they're still dealing with the long-term effects of what it was like to have a parent missing in the household or having maybe some anxiety and some aggression happening at home, short tempers. We're all exhausted, right? Everybody's exhausted. And so parenting from exhaustions, creating a gap in the ability to care for their kids the way that they wanted to. And so I have an amazing skill set from my mental health practice called dialectical behavior therapy. And that's one of the leading therapy models used for reducing suicide in the general population. And so I've been taking those skills and translating them over to the military population. And there's great skills for kids. And so I wanted to get the skills to the kids so that they can carry their rucks easier. I can't necessarily take everything out of their ruck for them. But I can highlight, you know, this is how you cope with things. This is how you validate yourself when maybe you're not living in the most validating environment right now. Mm-hmm. Get the visual of, in my workshops for adults, I put a ruck on their back. And like you said, I have them write on bricks and rocks and what their stressors nice. Are. And you put it in their back and I make them stand there and carry the weight. And so giving the visual for kids of what it's like when mom or dad comes home and their ruck's full and they start kind of unloading that ruck, sometimes in their ruck. Or yeah. in the house and the kids are running around kind of picking it up. What's that feel like? And so I wanted to just address it. I know sometimes it's not easy as parents to admit when we've, you know, maybe said or done something that we're not proud of. But modeling that, hey, we've all said or done things that we're not proud of. And how do we lean in and repair that? How do we model that we're going to make mistakes and that it's okay to just say, hey, you know what? I maybe overreacted and I'm sorry. And I do love you and I do care about you. And like, please tell me how you feel about that, where you're at, and hear them. And so getting that, so it would be a parent and child could come to the workshop and do it together.
If somebody was listening right now, well, which they will be, but what I'm saying is if there's somebody, if there's a spouse, maybe there is a child of a military member, whomever, and they're struggling in some way. What would be some of your recommendations of how they can maybe take steps to start on their journey of maybe towards healing or moving forward in their life?
Yeah. And so I would say that each spouse kind of has a different protective factors that are already in place. And so there's the ones who know how to call TRICARE and you know, military one source will give you so many free sessions for mental health care, and they'll assign you a therapist and all those things. So there's the spouses that know to do that or go to Psychology Today and filter through and look for who takes TRICARE, who's doing this, and read the profiles and kind of figure that out. There's the spouses who have been showing up to the FRG meetings or showing up to events, and they know who their chaplain is. And so I would say that's a great first start, because chaplains are literally embedded in units inside of organizations to know the resources, know what to do. And so that's a great foot in the door to just say, hey, I'm not really sure how I want to do that. And they're like, you know, counselors almost to a degree that can help you find resources or give you some support. And through my experience, I've talked to a lot of chaplains as well, because in my interviews with spouses, there's been some spouses who haven't had the best experience with some of the chaplains. And so I think it's important to know what's a good experience, what's a not a good experience. And if you walk away from somebody going, ew, that felt gross, I didn't like that, or that was very invalidating, then you get to say, I'm not done. Like, that doesn't stop here. And so that's the one piece of advice I want to give the most, is to say, if you've reached out for help and you sat down with the counselor and they just didn't understand and they're like, wow, what happened? And they're just overly shocked. And you're like, okay, I literally am like teaching you about me versus, you know, too much.
Right.
Or the chaplain just said, well, that's, you know, you kind of knew what you signed up for when you married somebody, and they do that, you know, right, little sweetheart kind of thing, which is rare. Then say, I'm not going to stop there. I'm going to keep going, and I'm going to reach out to somebody else. There are so many places and spaces if you put yourself out there. And it's so hard. It's so hard to tell a spouse who's struggling to say, and nobody's going to show up at your door and say, let me hold your hand and walk you through this, right? That's on you as well. All the stuff you're carrying is on you, and this is on you as well. And that's the really hard part about being a military spouse, is that we have to advocate for ourselves. You got to have that at least one friend, right? At least one friend that can use their wise mind when you're an emotion mind, that sure, can say, I can find the facts here, I can get you help here.
Right, right. That's very well said. Very well said. Richelle, where can they find out more information about you? And I want to add that your book hasn't launched yet. Before we get ahead of us or myself, when is the book scheduled to launch?
In September of 2021.
Oh, wow. So yeah. When this comes out, which will be episode, good Lord, now I even changed it, but back in, or will be in August, will be episode 23, and which will be coming out right before you look at your launch. So I'm really excited for that. But where can they go to find out more about you, more about the book, and more about the work that you do?
So they can find me at my website, RichelleFutch.com, or the website, HerRuck.com. Either of those would work out fine. And they can click on the workshop link, and it'll talk about my workshops as well.
Okay, perfect. And then is that the same for all the social media links and everything else?
Yes.
Perfect. Yeah. So if they want to, if you guys go out, check that out. Richelle, you also do, I don't want to forget that you also do a lot of, obviously being married to somebody in the special forces community, but you do a lot of work, not only through your private practice, but also with the special forces community and others as well, correct?
Correct, yeah.
And I don't want to forget that you were awarded as the 2019 Fort Bragg Military Spouse of the Year, isn't that correct?
That is correct. Yeah, that was a really big honor. Armed Forces Insurance does a great job every year of having nominations and recognizing military spouses at every installation. And so if somebody who loves a military spouse is out there and thinks that their spouse is doing a great job, they should nominate them.
I almost feel that the Armed Forces Insurance should be a sponsor of the show, because this is more than once that we've had somebody on the show that has been a award holder from, you know, for one of the years for whatever installation. And they do a very beautiful job of recognizing outstanding military spouses. So it's just really, of course I kid a lot, but they do a great job for the military community. Well, Richelle, thank you so much for being a guest today. We look forward to keeping tabs on what you're doing. And I'd be remiss if I didn't say thank you for your service.
Thank you so much for having me. It's been a pleasure.
Absolutely.